Father, we thank you for this time, Lord. We thank you for, Lord, just being with each one of us. And even, Lord, as we continue to study and learn, we pray, God, that we will be sensitive to your leading, that we will understand your word. We will, Lord, walk in obedience to your word, God. We thank you for this wonderful opportunity to learn together. And I pray, God, that you will minister to us even as we study, Lord. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Okay, so last class we did up to chapter 29. 29 was, sorry, we did up to 28, right? Justified and righteous by the blood. Now, I did give you all a little bit of assignment. Anybody remember what the homework was? Only Moses remembers. I know that Elizabeth remembers online. Thank you, Elizabeth, for, is that, I'm not sure if it's, no, Esther, right? Esther online put it. So I had, you know, asked you to write down the words and what the meaning of the words are, but it went like this and then it went up and went away. Okay, do that this week, okay? That's why I say make notes. You know, I still have my notes of Bible College. You want to see it? You want me to bring it and come? It's 16 years, 17 years old. I still have it. Still have it. The notes. My notebooks, all the books that we study, still have it. Okay, so that's why when you write, no, you'll remember, right? So write it down. Write it down in Hindi or whatever language that you feel like, right? So that you remember what you have to do. Okay, so let's get into chapter 29. So online students, I was just talking to the students here. I was saying that, you know, we're going to pick up a little more pace because we have quite a lot of content to cover. And so if there are places I'm going fast, it's only because I want to try and complete the portions on time, right? So let's go to chapter 29, no condemnation. Let's read Romans chapter 8 and verse 1. Now, these are verses that we must know by heart. You shouldn't even look at the notes. 2 Corinthians 5:17, Romans 8:1. Right? These are the common verses. Right? So it says, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Now, this is such a joy, right? Now there is no condemnation. We talked about this. What is condemnation? When somebody does something bad, right, there's condemnation on that person, right? So if a person is a thief and the thief has been caught, what happens? You see it, the locals will catch him, beat him up, and he's condemned, right? And not only is he physically condemned, he's inwardly also he's condemned. Hey, I'm a thief. And feeling condemned is not a good feeling. Is it a good feeling? Would you see a murderer or a thief smiling and saying, hi, how are you? It's a good day. No. They are feeling condemned. They want to cover their face. They want to hide. They want to run away. This condemnation. Hey, what will people think of me? Right? Now, the Bible says, now there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Are we in Christ Jesus? Yes. So I like the second part of the verse. Who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So sometimes we just take that first verse and hold on to that. The first portion of the verse says, therefore, now there is no condemnation. But there is no condemnation for who? For those who walk according to the Spirit. For them, there's no condemnation. Right? The word condemnation means a sentence, a guilty verdict, and a guilty conviction in our heart. That's called condemnation. Now, in the natural, do you and I receive, feel condemnation? Yes. It's a natural thing, right? So, for example, we may have sinned, right? We have done something wrong. We said something, got angry, and we shout at your friend or a relative or your parents. And then sometimes you feel, hey, what kind of a person I am? I shouldn't have. That's called condemnation. hey, I shouldn't have done. And then there is conviction. Conviction of the Holy Spirit brings us to repentance. Right? So conviction is the Holy Spirit will tell us, see, what you did was wrong. You shouldn't have got angry. You should have just stayed quiet. Right? But now what you do is you go back, ask forgiveness, make things right, and continue your walk with life. Right? That's called conviction of the Holy Spirit. But condemnation, oh, I did this, I did this, I did this. So nobody can help me. Nobody can change me. This is the way I am. I was born like this. All my friends call me this. That's called condemnation. Guilty, right? But when God looks at us, right, he looks at us as justified. Look, Satan is the accuser of the brethren. He brings condemnation, right? Let's look there. One of his strategies is to bring thoughts of accusation and condemnation against the believer. Now remember that Satan is a liar and he's the father of lies. So imagine you're getting into supernatural hour today, you're ready to worship God, and suddenly Satan, you know, the thought comes, you're ready to worship God. You know what you did yesterday? You did all these mistakes. He'll write down one list and show you. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 mistakes you have done. Now you're ready to worship God. With the same mouth, you're going to sing. Now what is that called? Accuser. He's accusing you of something. Is it true? Maybe true. Now there are times it's true. There are times it's not true. Right? But even if it's true, Bible says, now we are not in condemnation. So I like what I said last class, if the devil, you know, keeps telling you, okay, you did this wrong, this wrong, this wrong, what is the response for you and I as a believer? One, we can speak God's word. Two, you tell the devil, hey, I don't have to answer you. Do we have an account to give to the devil? Do we have an account? He has an account of us. But do we have an account with him? So we don't have to keep giving him. No, actually, devil, you know what happened? I was very tired that day. He doesn't know. He'll sit and listen. The devil is ready, right, to just keep on putting accusations. But you and I as believers don't have to do that. You can step away and say, hey, I'll give an account, but not to you. I'll give an account to God. I'll go back to God. Ask God to forgive me. Okay, everyone say now. No condemnation. Now. Not tomorrow. Not next week. Now. Right? Okay. So sometimes what the devil makes us feel is God is angry with you. How many of you have felt that? You're going to pray, God is upset with you. God is angry with you. God is angry with what you did. God will bring fire upon you. The fire of God will burn you out. Right? He'll make you scared. No, God will never use you in the ministry. Nothing you can do. Nothing. Right? You don't know you know Genesis, you don't know New Testament. You don't know Old Testament, nothing you know. Right? How you'll stand in front of people and preach. Now listen, all these things are true, right? It may sound silly, but it's true. He can make us feel that way, and he can make us feel that we are useless. If we are not careful, we'll think it's true. Oh yeah, God cannot use me. I am from a village. How can God use me? Maybe, you know, 20, 30 people, cell group I can do. But starting a church, blessing people in this entire nation, how can I do it? Now, if we say that, that's what will happen. But God is not somebody who looks at all of these other things, right? The enemy can bring these thoughts. So you say, no, God has called me, I will do it. Let's read this verse, Romans 8, 33 and 34. Is there a mic here? Okay. Romans 8, 33 and 34.
Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns. It is Christ who died, and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes an intercession for us.
Yeah, thank you. So there is no one, not even Satan, who can bring an accusation against us. Now, it's like this. What is the name, what does the word Satan means? Accuser, right? Will he bring accusation? He can. But even when he brings those accusations, right? That's what he does, right? He accuses us. He tells us, you didn't do this, you didn't do that, right? You are like this, you are like that, right? And even if he does that, what does the verse say? Who is he who condemns us? It is Christ who died and furthermore has risen, is even at the right hand, who makes intercession for us. That means what? Now, Jesus is not sitting in heaven saying, oh man, I've finished the work. I've done my job. On the cross, he said what? It is finished. Now, he's not in vacation mode now. Jesus is not on holiday. He's on the right hand of the Father, making intercession. Can you believe this? So, if I am being tempted, right? If Satan is tempting me and I'm saying, oh God, please help me. You know what Jesus is doing? Jesus is standing next to the Father and saying, Father, I know how that feels. Because I was also tempted by the devil. So he is making intercession for us, you and me. How many people, millions of people in this world, he's making it, he's doing it. He's standing, he's on our behalf, he's standing. So when the devil comes, all you have to do is make Jesus come and stand in front. You handle with Jesus, don't talk to me. That's all we have to do, because he's making intercession for us. And we can overcome the works of the devil. Right? Are you understanding what I'm trying to say? In heaven, Jesus is making intercession for us, saying, please help this boy. Please help this girl. You know, he's going through so much pain, so much difficulty, physical challenges, emotional pain. Help him. It's not like Jesus cannot do it. He's standing on our behalf. Right? It's not like he's asking the Father, you only should do it. No, he's standing on our behalf. He's praying for us, interceding for us. Right? So what more do we need? Do we need somebody greater than Jesus to pray for us? No. We have the greatest person praying for us. So now we don't have any condemnation. When we can reject, everyone say reject. The devil will come and say, you are like this. You reject. I reject that in Jesus' name. Right? I cancel those words in Jesus' name. He will come and tell you, you know, you are useless. You can do nothing in life. You say, I cancel that word in Jesus' name. Remember what Jesus said to Peter in the Garden of Gethsemane? No, not in the Garden of Gethsemane, before that, right? Peter says, before the trial, before Jesus was going through the trial, Peter said, Jesus, we will not let you die. Right? We will not let you die. We are there. We will take care of you. What does Jesus say? Get behind me, Satan. Why? Because Peter was, you know, trying to help Jesus, saying, oh, you know, Jesus, we have to protect you. But Jesus kept saying, I've come here for a reason, to die on the cross, right? So sometimes the enemy knows how to bring things and twist God's word. First, he says to Jesus, you take this stone, make it into bread. He said, man shall not live by bread. What did the second temptation, what did the devil do? Have you thought about it? He used God's word. He said, Psalms 91 says, if you throw yourself down, he will set his angels charge over you. The devil quoted Psalms 91. What did Jesus say? But it is also written, Don't test the Lord your God. So the devil can use scriptures and twist things and manipulate and make us fall into sin. God's grace is there, no? God is a gracious God. You can sin now. Later on, God will forgive you. Later, you go back to Jesus. He'll forgive you. Will he forgive? Yes. Is it true? Yes. But you see how he's manipulating the word of God. Right? So, it's very important as believers to understand your stand of victory that you are in. Your stand. Hey, I am standing in a place of victory. Now there is no condemnation. People will condemn. People will mock. Persecution will happen. Most of you are from North India. You have seen persecution. That will continue to happen. But you're not in condemnation. In God's presence, you're not in condemnation. Okay? So, because of no condemnation, we can enter God's presence in boldness. Chapter 30. Boldness to enter God's presence. Now, if you look at this in the natural, if a person who is a murderer or a thief, he's caught by the police, right? Now, he's put in the prison, but now he has to come to the courtroom. Because in the courtroom, the judge will sentence him 5 years, 10 years, or for life, whatever the judgment should happen. Have you seen any murderer or a thief smiling, walking in, saying hi to everyone, enjoying his thing, smiling? Oh, this is a good place, nice AC. Is he thinking of all that? No, there's no boldness there. He may be bold in the prison. Why? Because that's his territory. But, oh, is the video gone off? Yeah, it's better now. Okay. So, when he is in going into the court, there's no boldness there. Because he knows he's going to get convicted. Now, you and I, because there is no conviction, we have boldness to go into the presence of God. We don't have to say, God, can I talk to you for 5 minutes? No, you can just enter. Right? You can just go into his presence with boldness. Right? So every morning, you wake up in the morning, you pray. Right? Go in boldness. God is not going to judge you by how you look, what you pray, what words you use. Did you use the word justification, sanctification, redemption? If you use those words, he's not going to look at all that. Enter his presence through boldness. In boldness, confidence. Right? Let's read this. Ephesians 2, 13 and verse 18. Yes, anybody can read?
But now in Christ.
Go ahead.
Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. 18. For through him we both have access by one spirit to the Father.
Through him we have access to the, by one spirit to the Father. Now let me give you another example. Imagine you're going for a political meeting. Just an example, right? You're going to a political meeting. And in the political meeting, you're there, and then there's a backstage where all of these delegates are there, high delegates. Can you just walk in there? Can you just walk into the backstage? Hey, my name is Paul. They'll say, so what? What should I do if your name is Paul? Go from here, they'll say. Right? But if you have the access, you get a backstage access, one card, backstage VIP pass. Right? So you go there and you say, hey, my name is Paul. They'll say, so what? What should I do? See this, I have access, VIP access. So what will they say? Okay, go ahead. Now, to enter into God's presence, what does it say? For through him, you and I, we both have access by one spirit, no ID card, but the Holy Spirit inside us gives us the access to the Father. You understood? Right? So in the morning, whenever you're praying, you're just, maybe you're just saying a simple prayer, or you're praying in the spirit, you have access to the Father. I mean, have you thought about that? You have access to the Father. Jesus, you can talk to Jesus. His presence is there. He will speak to us. We have access to him. In the Old Testament, before they go into the most holy place, they cannot go. Only the high priest has access into that place. All of them could not go. But in the New Testament, we all have access. You can be driving, praying in tongues. You have access to the Father. Many a times, you know, while praying in tongues, I would have been riding the bike, just sitting, just doing some work. Suddenly an idea comes. Suddenly, you know, a problem was there in the work, or and then suddenly there's a solution. Right? Nothing I'm doing. I'm not even praying for that problem. Right? I'm not even praying for probably the person. But when they're praying in tongues, we have access to the Father. Father, God gives us the wisdom how to deal with the problem. I'll give you an example. I think I've given this example before. Have I given the example of my son when he was playing those games? No? Have I not? Okay. So my son was about 5 years old. He used to play this game on the phone called, it's a war game, right? So there was swords and killing and bloodshed and all of that. So I used to keep telling him, no playing that game. Because after some time, he stopped going into the room alone. The room is dark. So I got to know. So I keep telling him, don't play that game. So I stopped giving him the phone, everything. But what he would do is, he will download the game, play the game, and delete the game. Because I could see the latest downloads. So he did that for many. So I took, you know, I sternly warned him, lovingly I told him, no change. I said, God, what should I do with this boy? He's only 5 years old. I can't do much. If I tell also, he's not listening. So one day I was praying. I said, I was not praying for him. I was just praying. Suddenly I got an idea. It was like the Holy Spirit gave me a thought. When Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, Peter took the sword and cut the soldier's ear. What did Jesus say after that? Jesus said, those who live by the sword will die by the sword. I called my son, told him, made him sit. I opened, you know, the movie Passion of the Christ, right? Because if you show cartoon, he won't believe. That is cartoon, he'll say. So I opened Passion of the Christ. I went to that portion. Said, see, the soldier is cutting. Jesus is here. See what the soldier, what Jesus said. Those who live by the sword will die by the sword. Then I made him read that verse in the Bible. He read it. From that day till now, he doesn't use a phone. He doesn't use. Forget about games. He doesn't see the phone. He doesn't see TV. He's not interested in it. From that day till now, 3 years over, he doesn't see phone. He doesn't see TV. I was struggling for 6 months on my own, but it's gone inside. It was like the word of God has gone deep inside him. He doesn't even want a phone. He doesn't even want games. Nothing he wants. No, I don't. Want to watch TV? No. Good for me. But it's gone inside. That's the word of God. Now, why did I give this example? The reason is, when you and I understand that, you know, this conviction that God brings is from the Holy Spirit, it will change our life. We cannot live the same. It doesn't matter about age, our standing in society, all of that doesn't matter. Look at this. Hebrews 4:16. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the times of need. Remember the last couple of chapters we saw, we are not coming by our own works. We are coming by the blood of Jesus. Works are there, but we don't come in by works. Right? 1 John 3 verse 20 and 21. For if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart and knows all things. Verse 21. Beloved, if our hearts does not condemn us, we have confidence towards God. So what does it say here? John is teaching us in these two verses. He's teaching us to live free of condemnation. Now, the condemnation will come. It's a choice whether we receive it or not. Yes or no? It's our choice. If I want to receive it, I'll receive it. If people say say something wrong, say something bad about me, if I receive it, I receive it. If I reject it, it's good. It is my choice. So John is saying here that if our heart condemns us, remember that God is greater than our heart. He knows everything that's happening in our heart, right? And if our heart is not condemned, then we have confidence towards God. So you and I must maintain a heart attitude that does not get condemned very easily. Now, this condemnation can also come through people in your own family. Your close friends may condemn you. They may say, hey, you are like this. So you must be able to have the right heart attitude. It's developed over time. Say, okay, even my best friend, my loved ones may say this, but I know that God loves me. I know that God cares for me. Now, is it hurtful when our friends, family, condemn us? Very hurtful. But we maintain that heart and say, God, I know you love me. This is a painful season I'm going through, but you help me. Right? So we must maintain that heart attitude. However, if our heart is still condemned, we must remember that God is greater than our heart and knows all things. That is, God knows the truth. So we must look at things through God's perspective. That means, the word perspective means, now we have one way of looking at certain things. God has another way of looking at certain things. I always wonder, why didn't God do it this way? Look at the example of David. King David. God told him, you'll become a king. 13 or 14 years old. Now, he could have, Saul knew it. This small boy is going to become king of Israel. Now, what could have Saul done? And God could have told Saul, okay, Saul, get ready. You train this small boy. Right? Train him up. Teach him everything on how to be a king. Right? How to raise up an army. How to attack, how to, build a kingdom, how to have administration, structure, how to develop the country, how to bring up people in the economy of the country. All of those things. You train David. Why didn't God do it that way? Simply all this, no? 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, you see David is running here, David is running there. Then 300 people are coming. Why all of this? Instead of that, the story could have been, David went, sat in the palace, 9 to 5, he trained in the palace, went back home and slept. Come back 9 to 5, for 5 years he did that and he became king. So is it a better story? It is very simple. Simple story. Like how we become pastors. Father is a pastor. The son is a pastor. The son is born. By the time he's 5, he's already singing. By the time he's 10, he's already preaching. By the time he's 18, he's already youth leader. 20, he's pastor. Why? Because all his life he's seen his father. Simple. Done the same thing, but no. It was not done that way. Because sometimes we feel this is the right way. But God's perspective is different. God wants it in a different way. So we must think of God's way in our life. I always say, all right, there's a clock. We can read time on our way, or we can read time God's way. We should learn to read time on God's clock. God, is it time for me to do this? Is it time for me to go here? Is it time for me to start a ministry? Is it time for me to do this? Read from God's clock, right? Understand to hear from Him. He will speak, right? So in this chapter, we looked at, let's read this portion, Hebrews 10, 19 to 22. It's an important passage. Therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which He consecrated for us through the veil, that is, His flesh, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Right? So it's wonderful. The book of Hebrews talks a lot about, you know, all of this entering God's presence. We must draw with full assurance of faith. We cannot go into God's presence and saying, God, are you there? Are you there, God? No, I know I made a mistake. Are you there? No, He's there. Full assurance, full faith. God is there, right? With boldness and confidence, our hearts must be sprinkled and washed of evil conscience. That means what? The word of God and the work of the Holy Spirit that cleanses our heart and our inner person. We must keep washing ourselves. In the natural, all of us, after wearing a shirt, or if you know that the shirt is dirty, what do? Wash it. Right? We can't keep saying, no, I washed it in 2020. 2020, I washed this shirt. So from 2020 till now, I will not wash because it's still good. No. Every time you constantly wash it, you keep using it, right? Now, if you look at clothes can last for 10 years, 12 years, right? But in the 10 and 12 years, you have looked after it properly. Yes or no? Right? You have washed it on time. You have made sure it dries in the sun or whatever that has to be done, right? And made sure that you looked after your clothes well. It's washed. How many of you can say how many, you know, in 3 years, how many times you washed a shirt? Do you have a count? No, because you have kept washing it, kept wearing it, and it'll continue till it wears out. The same way, our spirit needs to be sprinkled with water, meaning the Holy Spirit keeps washing us. We keep going back. I cannot say, Lord, 2018 I became pastor, so now from 2018 till now I will not keep cleansing myself and praying to the Holy Spirit. No, but I have to keep doing it constantly, right? So the Holy Spirit washes our heart. He from self-condemnation, he lets our heart, you know, just into a place of confidence, assurance that God loves us. How many of you know that God loves you this morning? Must know that His mercy is there. Think of the cross. Think of what Jesus did. Now, today, this morning, before coming, somebody sent me a clip, right, of how Jesus fed the 5,000. Did you ever think about it? You know, sometimes we read it. Jesus fed 5,000. How? Five loaves of bread and two fish. Can 10 people eat five loaves of bread and two fish? Or how many people? Yeah, 50 people in Bible college, we order so much food. Right? 5,000 people. Five loaves of bread and two fish. What did Jesus do? He prayed and He said, go and give it. You see the God, you see our God, how powerful He is. He's able to do such wonderful things. He's able to do such great miracles. And sometimes we limit God, no? We think, okay, God cannot do this. Or we'll ask everyone else, then we'll ask God. No. I have this assurance. Go back to God and God will answer us. Let's go to chapter 31. Is there any questions? Feel free to ask those who are online. Feel free to ask. Okay. I'm just going to keep going. 31. Reigning in life because of the gift of righteousness. Romans 5:17. Yes. Anyone can read?
For if by the one man's offense, death.
Go ahead. I think, Lucy, your internet is breaking off. Your voice is breaking off. I think it's of the internet. Can you start again, please? Romans 5:17.
Yes, brother. For if by the one man's offense, death reigned through the one, much more does those who receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one Jesus Christ.
By one man's offense, death reigned. How much more those who received the abundance of grace and the gifts of righteousness through the one Jesus Christ. One man's offense. What did Adam do? Don't eat, he ate. Sin came into the world. Right? Did God design death? When God created the heavens and the earth, did he say man will live and die? No. He just created man. He didn't say death is there. But through Adam's sin, death came into this world. Now, because death came, Satan had victory. Did Adam raise from the dead? Is he living now? No. So death had victory. So who had victory that time? Satan. Satan had victory. He had dominion. He had power. He had authority. Now, all the way till Jesus, even though God was doing great, wonderful miracles, and we read all about it happening in the Old Testament, but still, Satan has his dominion, his authority. It was there because there was death. And Satan had not been defeated. See, Satan was thrown from heaven down, and he was working, and his demons are working. They were not defeated. But on the cross, when Jesus died, what did he do? He defeated the devil. That means he said, devil, no, he died, he rose again from the dead. He said, devil, now you brought death into this world. You brought sin into this world. So what have I done? I have taken up the sins of the world and I have overcome death. What you brought death into this world. I've overcome it. Now I'm alive. Now can you kill me again? You cannot, because you're defeated. And so what this one Adam did, he brought sin into this world. How much more Jesus, through one act, has brought us into a place of righteousness. One act. Now, physically, will we die? Yes. But spiritually, we will live with him. There's victory. Right? So Satan has been defeated. Satan has, through Christ we have been justified and brought out of subjection to sin, Satan, and death. The gift of righteousness qualifies us to reign in life. Okay, what is the meaning of reign in life? The word reign in life means to be victorious at all times. Right? If you look at a sport, for example, hey, this runner was reigning from the year 1990 to 2010. That means for this 20 years, no one was as good as him. Wherever he went, he won. Whichever tournament he participated in, he won. Because he's the best. 20 years. He reigned in the running field for 20 years. Now Jesus is saying, reigned not for life, not for 20 years, but reigned for life. He's calling us to be walk in victory for our entire life. Not for 3 years Bible college. For our entire life. Right? Romans 5:18. Therefore, as through one man's offense, judgment came into this world, or into all men, resulting in condemnation, even so, through one man's righteous act, the free gift came to all, resulting in justification of life. So now you and I can say, hey, I'm reigning victorious for the rest of my life. Why? Because Jesus is calling me victorious. Because I believe in Jesus. Now, India won the World Cup. They're not, you know, reigning forever. Right? Next World Cup, they lost, gone also. You never know what's going to happen next. Those victories are going to keep changing. But this victory is forever. Everyone say forever. Till the end of your life, even on in the deathbed, we can smile and say, oh man, I'm waiting to meet with Jesus. Why? Then the devil will come and say, hey, you're not scared of dying. No, what is there to be scared? Why scared? I'm going to meet Jesus. Who's victory? Who's won? You know, I had this wonderful opportunity to, well, I was not yet a believer, but I will never forget this. My grandmother was a wonderful woman of prayer. Every time praying, whole day she's praying, whole night she's praying. I used to ask her, why do you pray so much? Praying for all of you. How can you pray so much? Whole night you're praying. You don't have anything else to do. Right? I remember being so rude to her. But one thing was, I was at work. I was in office. And we got the call that, you know, I was in the corporate sector, that she's unwell and she's going to pass away anytime. And we all went to the house, and my grandmother was lying there on the bed. I will never forget this. Right? She was singing songs. Okay? And then we would say, Grandma, we've come to... How are you feeling? Oh, it's a beautiful place. Oh, how I can see my master's face. All that she's saying. So I didn't understand. So, but everyone else understood that she's already almost there. She's halfway into heaven. Oh, what a beautiful place. What a joy it is. She's singing songs, hymns. Loudly she's singing. Right? And she's in so much pain, but she's singing. Oh, what a joy it is. And smiling and in joy, she died. None of us in the house cried. None of them cried. I said, if I die, when I die, I want a death like this. None of them cried. Their own children, nobody cried. And I was looking at everyone. How come nobody's crying? Nobody cried. Why? Because we know she's in a better place. But now I understand after becoming a believer. Right? That I wasn't a believer, but I knew, hey, this is victory. Nobody's crying. Nobody cried. We went home, we had biryani, we ate and slept. Was the hurt there? Yes. But nobody cried. Nobody moaned for the death. Oh, well, no. What a beautiful death. Now, you and I are reigning in life. Physically, we may go. We will go someday. But the devil has been defeated. The devil has no claim over our life. They will come and say, oh, you're going to die now. Okay, so what are you going to do? Yeah, I'm going to go to heaven. I'm going to be with the Lord Jesus. To be absent in the body is to be present with the Lord. Story closed. The devil is going to run away. But that conviction should be there for us. We must reign victorious. We must reign in life. Right? Chapter 32. Quickly, we have 5 minutes. Let's look if we can try and finish this chapter. The armor of righteousness, Ephesians 6. Now, in Ephesians 6 is, Paul talks about the armor of God, right? He's talking to the believers. He's saying, therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand therefore, girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness. Right now, Paul is painting a picture of a Roman guard. How many of you have seen a picture of a Roman guard? Romans, have you seen? The Roman soldiers, what do they wear? They have those big helmets and the guard here, the chest guard and a belt, and they have a sword and they're ready. Now he's painting a picture. He's saying to the believers, therefore take up, you know, so the NIV says, put on the armor of God. Right? So that means we have to put it on. The armor is there. Put it on. You put it on. Paul is saying, put on. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God so that when the enemy comes, you'll be able to withstand him. Nowhere in the Bible later on does Paul say, take out the armor for some time. Just put it on at all times. What is that armor? It's having girded your waist with the truth and the breastplate of righteousness. You know, this portion of our body, the breastplate, the breast area, this area is the most important area. Yes or no? If a sword comes and goes right into you or an arrow, what will happen? We will die. But if a sword goes into our leg, or arrow goes into the leg, we can still survive?
Yeah.
If it goes on my shoulder, can we survive? Yes. But this portion, if it goes into our neck, what will happen? Gone. Right? This portion, right, is important. So Paul is saying, this is the breastplate of righteousness, the most important part. Right? You cover yourself so that you can stand. Imagine a soldier, if he's going for war, okay, and he's not worn the breastplate. Hey, I forgot, it's at home. I've come for war. What is he going to do? He's going to stand sideways. Why? Because arrows are going to come. Or what's he going to do? He can't do anything. He has to cover himself. He's not going to be effective in the war at all. They'll say, hey, you go back home. Wear your equipment and come back. So Paul is saying here, put on the righteousness, the breastplate of righteousness. Don't forget it. Because the devil will come shooting his arrows. That time you can just stand. Okay, shoot. The breastplate is there, nothing will happen. You are a failure. One arrow is falling to the ground. It's not gone inside. You are a loser. You can never be successful. All of these arrows of the devil, but it's hitting the breastplate of righteousness. The arrow, the breastplate is saying, hey, I have a right standing before God. Arrows are not doing anything to him. Right? 2 Corinthians 6:7. Did you understand that? Everyone are looking at me like, what is he saying? Are you understanding? Right? 2 Corinthians 6:7. By the word of truth and by the power of God, by the armor of righteousness on the right hand and on the left. So we talked about righteousness, right? That no matter what happens, no matter what the devil says, you and I, when we go back, even if we have sinned, we go back, ask Jesus to forgive us. You and I have a right standing before God. That does not change. That will not change. If we've asked for forgiveness, we have a right standing before God. The devil will throw arrows, but you say, hey, I have the armor of righteousness, and this is who I am. Right? So we'll pick up from chapter 33 next class, fellowship in righteousness, and also going forward, if there are questions, you can feel free to, you know, those online can put it on the chat, but we can also take some time to, you know, to answer some questions if you have. All right, have a great weekend. God bless you all. I'll see you next week.